First of all, I just want to recap real quickly. We just launched the Intel Core Ultra Series 3. As you know, much better battery life. My near and dear, 77% better graphics performance. It's our largest integrated GPU ever built. We're 60% faster on CPU performance, and we're approximately 2x on AI performance. So it's an absolutely incredible part. It is better in perf per watt as well, so we're about 10% more performance at a similar power, and we're far better than our prior generation. If you look at the integrated graphics, it's Xe3 IP, first instance of Xe3 IP, and it's named the Intel Arc B390 in its largest configuration. If you think about it, it's 12 Xe cores delivering 120 TOPS, 16 megabyte cache, 96 XMX units. So it's all in all really a very high-end GPU in an integrated package. I love to give this fact. Damian told me the other day that if you looked at all the installed AI PC engines that we've already shipped, Meteor Lake and Lunar Lake combined, do you know how many computational units are out there, sir? Computational units deployed already in over 100 million PCs. Any idea? 100 million times 120, it's a big number. It's 4 zettaops. 4 zettaops. Yeah, that's 4 billion trillion, or 4 trillion billion, whatever you like. It's a lot, you know. All right, so here we go. This generation, we are 77% faster graphics and 53% faster AI. If you look at some charts here, I'm big into charts, 76% faster versus our prior generation. This is the B390 versus the Arc 140T. And you can see across all games, this is 19 by 10 with 2x supersampling enabled. If you look at us compared to other titles, this is versus AMD, 73% faster, again with 2x supersampling turned on. This is FSR versus XeSS. Very comparable technologies. And if you look at without super sampling, we're 82% faster than our closest AMD competitor. So at the end of the day, our graphics update is pretty spectacular, and we are dominating pretty much everybody in the same segment. One thing I love is that if you look at Qualcomm, we're 2.6 times faster than Qualcomm, and a lot of these games don't run, but we didn't count those in the average. So we're not counting zeros. It's 2.6x on the games that ran. This is actually shocking to me, which is pretty exciting. If you think about it, our performance is similar to a 4050 laptop from NVIDIA. So that means that for the first time, our integrated product, which is lower power, this is actually running at 45 watts sustained compared to 60 watts for a 4050. That's about launched at CES 3 years ago, hit the market kind of mid 2.5 years ago. We're already at that performance, which means that our rate of closure of integrated graphics versus discrete for notebooks is accelerating, which is pretty exciting. Integration, by the way, always wins. You know integration wins. All right, so modern rendering, we also do XeSS 3. We launched that with Panther Lake and our Xe3 IP. It gives us ability to do better lighting, sharper visuals, and ultimate smoothness. It's a pretty cool technology. It uses AI to generate frames. We do one network to generate optical flow. So we're looking at prior frames compared to this frames with an AI network. We generate optical flow, and we use that with a kind of an auto correlation network, again, a neural network, to generate 3 frames for that 1 rastered frames. And it gives us up to 4 times the amount of frames. It's much more power efficient, and it smooths out the experience dramatically. We have demos of that in the back, so definitely try it out. And you can even try it out on your PCs. This is our XeSS overdrive. It's our override for the amount of frames. So if you have any title that is XeSS 2, which is our existing frame generation technology, then we can use our driver, our panel, to change that to be XeSS 3. So no game integration is required, and you can just shift your game from 2 frames up to 3 or 4 with an override in our control panel. This actually is going to work on all of our GPUs that support systolic. So think of it as Meteor Lake, Lunar Lake, Battle Mage, Alchemist, all support XeSS 3. All right, that's the product. I wanted to talk a little bit about smoothness, because when you get into the world of frame generation, you know, kind of the metrics of FPS are less valuable, because the generated frames are not the same as rastered frames. And it's been a real pushback that I've heard from the industry. So how do we solve that? But we need to start changing the way we talk about it. So with our new version of PresentMon, which is a tool that we make, we now report three different measures of FPS. The first one is FPS app. You can think of that as raster. It's whatever your application rastered. It has nothing to do with frame gen. The second one is FPS presents. That's the one that includes all the frame gen stuff. So you can see that FPS presents is about 4x higher than FPS apps. That's with 3x generation. And then this last one is display, which is how many frames actually ended up on the screen, which can be different again. Okay, so this is a little bit more transparent way to report graphics performance for frame gen. But there's more. So we're talking a lot about smoothness these days. It's not just performance, it's about smoothness. So we're introducing a new way to measure that called animation error. This is already built into PresentMon. It's on the systems you've got. And it's a way to kind of say, how smooth is my gaming experience? So let me tell you how it works. Let's start with what is animation? Animation is just a series of images generated by the render pipeline, right? It looks a lot like this. This is a Tom Petersen PowerPoint animation. And that is perfect animation. Right, we're running 60 frames at around 100 milliseconds per frame. It went across the screen. It generated these evenly spaced circles with even time. Right, so even space and even time means that you're getting a smooth experience. That's perfection. So it comes from this pipeline. Right, this is the way games render. There's the CPU pipeline over here, and it starts with getting the current time, and then it generates an update to game state, which is like what position should the ball be based on the current time, and then it converts that through a render process to set of GPU commands that get rendered into a picture, and eventually that picture gets put on the screen. Okay, so this is what I call open loop, which means that this can run at an arbitrary rate, and it doesn't get matched out here. So that's where the error comes from. That's where stutter comes from. So if you think about what that looks like, this is perfection. CPU is doing its uniform thing. Render is happening, it's getting put on the display perfectly. All the steps, this is 10 milliseconds between the frame, you'll see animation move forward 10 milliseconds. Down here on the flip, it also matches that 10 milliseconds, so everything's great. Now, what can go wrong? A lot of things can go wrong. Here's my animation, look for it, right there. Okay, so what happened? If you kind of come back, you're saying, you know, we're rendering, everything's going great, but then maybe the CPU stuttered. The CPU did a network activity, or maybe it was loading a new texture, or maybe it was, you know, just running out of cache and it had a flop. So it's this gap, this little like hitch that we all perceive as lack of smoothness. And the way we're measuring it today is this thing that we call percentiles, where you're thinking 1%, 5%, 10% percentiles captures that effect. But that's not actually true. So what does capture that effect is animation error. And the way it works is it says, what is the animation step that we know is in that frame? The animation step is, you know, how far are things going to be moving forward? If the velocity is constant and the time step is bigger, it's going to move further. So this is taking a 4x step in that picture. Now, the problem is that this 4x step was caused by a CPU delay. The render pipeline, the rest of this GPU, you know, display doesn't know anything about it. So when it gets the first frame, it puts it on the screen, but it stays there because it doesn't get the second frame. The second frame is stalled on the CPU, but eventually when it comes, it does show. But all of this means that things are showing up at the wrong time in the wrong place. So that's what animation error measures. It measures how wrong are we showing things at either the wrong time or the wrong place. Is that all making sense so far? That's all built into PresentMon today. Animation error is a new way to measure performance. It measures smoothness. Frame gen will have an impact on that, but we don't include that yet. It's probably better than all this percentile stuff. If you guys remember, I'm a big advocate of measuring smoothness through percentiles. This is a better way to do that. And I'm looking for feedback. So if you try it out, let me know what you think. We're open to change. It's in beta now. It's in the PresentMon that we make public. It's in all the major tools.